Okay, I'm going to let's pray. We've welcomed everybody else. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that in some ways we shouldn't and don't need to welcome you, because actually you were already here. And we want to thank you for that, and that you are already here because of what we celebrated last weekend, the death and resurrection of Jesus and his ascension, that he is now at your right hand, and that because of that, he sent your Holy Spirit here to be with us and amongst us. We pray, Lord God, that we would get a sense of that presence here today, that we would grasp something else about the death, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus, and what that means for each one of us on this day, in this place, in Galashiels. May all that we do bring glory and honour to you, because you're worth it. Amen. So yes, last weekend was, last Sunday was Resurrection Day. I want to read a passage from Colossians chapter 1, 15 to 20. I'm going to read it in the Message translation, and I've asked for the word not to go up on the screen, because it is absolutely packed with images. So get caught up in some of the images that this passage will spark off in your mind. The title of this text is Christ Holds It All Together. We look at this sun and see the God who cannot be seen. We look at this sun and see God's original purpose in everything created. For everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, rank after rank after rank of angels, everything got started in him and finds its purpose in him. He was there before any of it came into existence, and holds it all together right up to this moment. And when it comes to the church, he organizes and holds it together like a head does a body. Hallelujah, Ewan and worship team, leadership team. When it comes to Galashiels Baptist Church, he organizes and holds it together like a head does a body. He was supreme in the beginning, and leading the resurrection parade, he is supreme in the end. From beginning to end, he's there, towering far above everything, everyone. So spacious is he, so roomy, that everything of God finds its proper place in him without crowding. Not only that, but all the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms, get properly fixed and fit together in vibrant harmonies. All because of his death, his blood that poured down from the cross. Hallelujah. Thanks be to God for his word. So last Sunday was Resurrection Sunday. We had the challenge of entering this week past living that in that resurrection life that changes things from death to life, from fear to joy. I wonder, how have you managed this week? Have you lived in resurrection life? Is it a thumbs up? a thumbs down, or maybe a thumbs not sure. Maybe you sat here thinking, do you know what, I could do with doing that all over again and being reminded and start again. Anybody in that situation? Let's have another go at it, God. Well, do you know what? About 200 million Christians across this world will today be celebrating Resurrection Sunday. So we could join with them and start all over again. These people, 200 million of them, are the ones that belong to the Orthodox Church. Christians just like you and I, who believe the Bible, worship God, honour Jesus in what they do. But somewhat differently, a lot of these people live in those eastern areas of Europe. So Russia, Ukraine, Kazakhstan, all these different countries. For them, their buildings are very important, filled with lots of pictures and ornate things. Buildings are important, but actually, they believe that actually God is everywhere. So I want you to perhaps think about those Ukrainians who perhaps have seen their buildings bombed and destroyed. I want you to think about those Ukrainians who've had to leave behind and find themselves now in a country where they can't celebrate Easter in the way that they would have done. Maybe today, pray for those our Christian brothers and sisters across Europe. 200 million of them. That was a shock to me. But anyway, back to us here today. We have a chance then. Let's say that Resurrection Sunday is today. If it wasn't for St. Cuthbert, who roamed these parts, we might actually be like those Orthodox Christians. We might actually have been celebrating Resurrection today if it had not been for St. Cuthbert. So let's try what we did last week with that proclamation. He is risen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Do you know what though? We don't actually need two Resurrection Sundays. Do you know what? Every day we can proclaim he is risen, because actually, do you know what? He is risen indeed, and it has a bearing on absolutely every day. We're going to sing now about the cross and the resurrection. Happy days. Oh, happy day when Jesus washed my sins away. Let's bring our praise and our thanks to God for all that he accomplished through the life and the death, the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus. Let's sing, please.
Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross and the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And happy day, happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. When I stand in that place, free at last, meeting face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. Endless joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will cease. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way that you have saved me. And oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious name. Yeah. Oh, happy day, happy day. You washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed. I'll never be the same.
Please remain standing for our next song. Creatures of the God and King, lift up your voice and let us sing. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, oh, praise Him, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Let all things their Creator bless, and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia. All the redeemed washed by His blood, come and rejoice in His great love. To reign, heaven and earth will join to sing. Oh, praise Him, alleluia. bended knee. Oh, creatures of our God and King, oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him. Alleluia, alleluia, oh, praise Him, oh, praise Him. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Father, we thank you that you are Lord. There is none like you. You have risen and you are now seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us. What a mighty God we serve, and what a joy it is to lift our praises to you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
A time for prayer. He's our Lord. He's our Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He's our Lord. And our knees shall bow, and our tongues confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father God, we thank you for your creation, the beauty that surrounds us, from the amazingness of the mountains and the hills to the awesomeness of the sea, from the buzzards circling high overhead to the microbes that break down the compost. Lord, your intricate patterns, your interlinking, your design of the world with all its relationships to balance life in all its fullness, you have created and you maintain an amazing world. Today, as we look out at the sunshine, as spring moves onwards, thank you for the beauty of creation. Lord, as we celebrate this time of year, we recognize that the season of Easter also continues. Thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who you gave freely, who knew the destiny of his life here on earth, in all its pain and darkness. Yet together it would be, is, and was the way to bring relationships back between you and us. Lord, thank you for the relationships we have with each other here in this family we call our church, but also our relationships with our immediate family, our wider family and friends. Praise you, Lord, for the relationship of Father, Son and Holy Spirit, God in three persons, Blessed Trinity. Thank you that Jesus has walked the path of human relationships, mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, friends. He knows the joys and the challenges of relationships, the pleasure of being close, but the pain of being misunderstood, the breakdown in communication, the pain of wrong words and deeds, the breaks in relationships that so often occur. Thank you, Lord, that you have walked this path yourself and that you walk this path with us, sharing with us in the joys and delighting in the fantastic times, but also that pain and hurt. Lord, so often we know that it's our thoughts, our words, our deeds that have caused this pain and hurt to others, to ourselves and to you, Lord. Lord, we confess that we've not always acted in the way that we should have done, through our weaknesses or our deliberateness, or we failed to act as we should. Oh, Lord, we bring to mind some of these things now. Lord, forgive us our sins, that grace, Lord, that you so freely give, let us not take for granted, but let us be graceful to others and forgive them the wrongs they've done for us. Lord, we bring before you the needs of the world. Lord, it's not just the immediate items that are in the news, but the long-term effects that events have on people and places, the physical, economic, social and cultural effects that may impact on places for many years to come. We recall those who are suffering because of natural disasters. We think especially of the flooding that we've heard recently about in Africa. We know the ongoing war between Russia and Ukraine. Lord, as news continues to share the effects, the physical, cultural, religious, social, emotional and personal cost to individuals, to families, communities and countries. Lord, be close to those. Lord, we bring before you the needs of our country, the ongoing effect of coronavirus, inflation that makes so families make so many difficult decisions. Lord, we pray for those in authority over us in Westminster and Holyrood. Lord, you have placed our leaders over us, but we do pray for integrity. Lord, that we can trust them to make decisions that are best for the majority, not just for us. We also pray for the upcoming local elections, that those who are elected will be fair and honest, representing the views of their community. We pray for our community, Lord, those that are our neighbours, who live on our street. Lord, for a few moments, we bring them to mind and their needs and share them with you. Lord, we pray for our church, our witness to the community. Lord, pray for guidance and aspirations for our church leadership team as they seek to express our vision here in Galashiels. Thank you for the groups and the individuals in our church, Lord. Although we meet as a church to witness, may our individual lives as your disciples be a witness to your love and your compassion. And Lord, we bring our individual needs to you, those which are close to our hearts and our minds. Thank you, Lord, that you are a faithful God that walks through us, walks with us. Amen.
For the fellowship today, we shall be reading from the book of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 11 to 20. Matthew 28, chapters 11 to 20. While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priest everything that had happened. When the chief priest had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, 'His disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep.' If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Amen.
All my days I will sing this song of gladness, give my praise to the fountains of delights, for in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of mercy poured down on my life. I will trust in the cross of my Redeemer. I will sing of the blood that never fails, of sins forgiven, of conscience cleansed, of death defeated and life without end. Beautiful Savior, wonderful Counselor, Holy Majesty, Lord of History, you're the way, the truth, the life, Star of the morning, glorious in holiness, you're the risen one, heaven's champion, and you reign. You reign over all. I long to be where the praise is never ending, yet to dwell where the glory never fades, where countless worshippers will sing one song, and cries of worthy will honor the Lamb. Beautiful Savior, wonderful Counselor, clothed in majesty, Lord of history, you're the way, truth, the life, Star of the morning, glorious in holiness, you're the risen one, heaven's champion, and you reign, beautiful Savior, wonderful Counselor, clothed in majesty, Lord of history, you're the way, the truth, the life, star of the morning, glorious in holiness. You're the risen one, heaven's champion, and you reign, you reign over all.
Please come up. Father God, we want to thank you for bringing Ewan to our fellowship. We thank you for him as our pastor. We thank you that this last week, we trust you that your Holy Spirit has been speaking to him as he's been praying and pondering and preparing this word which he's going to bring. We ask that you would, this very moment, fill him with your Spirit. Lead and guide everything that is in his mind, and that he will speak. Empower him, Lord, by your Spirit, to bring your word to us at this time, in this place. And Father, Holy Spirit, would you be moving among us, and would you enable us to listen to Ewan, to listen to you, to lean in to what you are speaking to us as a church, what you're speaking to us as individuals. And would you help us all, would you help us all to learn more about you, that we may be better disciples, that we may take up the challenge to go and make disciples of all nations. So we offer ourselves to you at this time. Make your word living and active in our lives and in our fellowship. For Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen.
Amen.
I'd just like to say, and to be brave enough to speak on behalf of all of us as well, to say what a blessing it's been to have Sylvia leading us in our worship this morning. Sylvia, thank you so much for the time and the energy and the prayer and the thought that you've put into leading this morning. It's been such a blessing. In the year 1764... the philosopher Voltaire claimed that we are living in the twilight of Christianity. We are living in the twilight of Christianity, he said. He claimed that in around 100 years, Christianity would be as good as extinct and nobody would be reading the Bible. Now, you may know the story that less than 100 years later, his property was being used to print and produce Bibles. But nevertheless, Voltaire would not be alone in thinking that we are living in the twilight of Christianity, not be alone in thinking that Christianity is on the way out. No matter what year it's been, whether it's 1764, whether it's 2022, there are people who constantly say Christianity is on the way out. They'll talk about how Christianity is absurd, of how the claims of Christianity are irrational. How could you really believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead? How can you believe in miracles? How can you believe in all that nonsense? Or you may be familiar with the claims that Christianity is in its twilight because it doesn't matter anymore. It's irrelevant. What's the point? We've moved on. We're in a new era. We're in the 21st century. We don't need any of that anymore. Or maybe you'll hear people say that we're in the twilight of Christianity because Christianity doesn't help. In fact, it does more harm than good. Religion doesn't help anybody. Let's just get rid of it and move on with our lives. God doesn't exist. Now enjoy your life as the slogan went round saying. But maybe yourself, sitting here this morning, you've been tempted to believe we're in the twilight of Christianity. Hearing about the so-called decline of Christianity, especially in our nation, where more and more people are affiliating as nones, as no religion, no religious affiliation whatsoever. We'll see what the latest census gives us on that. But the picture doesn't necessarily look good. With churches closing down, or churches like the Church of Scotland in our own town going from 3 buildings to 1 congregation. With churches closing down, with congregations not returning after COVID as well. With bare spots in our churches. What I mean by that is when we look around in our churches and in our congregations and we think, what are the demographics that aren't present? Maybe we too are tempted to believe that we are in the twilight of Christianity. We are living in the twilight of Christianity, Voltaire said. This claim has been around from the beginning. This claim has been around from the very day that Jesus rose from the dead, as Matthew tells us in his gospel, in Matthew chapter 28. While the women were on their way to tell of the good news, of the claims of Christianity, that Jesus Christ has risen, that he is not here, he is risen from the dead. While they were on their way to tell that wonderful good news, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. Now, the chief priests gather together. It's essentially like an emergency leadership meeting, like a cobra meeting, if you like. The gathering of the religious leaders in Jerusalem, the Sanhedrin, marked by the fact that the chief priests and the elders were there, just 2 of the 3 parties. And they gave the soldiers, they met with the elders and devised a plan. And they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You're to say, his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep." Confronted with the claim of Christianity that he is risen, he is not here, he has risen from the dead, the religious leaders, knowing what that claim would mean for them, were determined to claim otherwise. His disciples came and stole the body. Don't bother following Jesus. It's not true. People don't really rise from the dead. The claim that, or the argument that people make today, that people who are dead don't rise from the dead, was the same thing that people were saying in Jesus' day as well. We're not the enlightened moderns that have suddenly worked it all out. Back then it was the same. When people die, they do not rise from the dead. The resurrection stories that we hear, like of Lazarus, were stories of resurrection, yes, but Lazarus was going to die again, and others who were raised by Jesus were going to die again. They did not believe in Jesus' time that the dead rise. They believed in a day when everyone will rise, but they did not believe that one man in the middle of history, in the center of history, would rise from the dead. And so they claimed a different narrative, a narrative that secured for them their power, their wealth, kept things just the way they wanted. A narrative that stopped any challenge, any confrontation to what they were already doing. The disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. That was the guard's report. He hasn't been risen from the dead. We were right to put him to death. What are some of the worldviews, some of the things that they were protecting with this narrative? Because when it comes to deception and when it comes to lies, when it comes to being faced with the claim that Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead, there's always something to gain by telling a different story. For the priests, it was security. It was keeping their power. It was not being confronted with what the risen Jesus meant for their lives. And it's interesting that they use that very motivation for themselves to tap in to how to manipulate the guards. The priests know that they have to protect their own security, and so they give an offer to the guards based on the guards' security as well. We'll give you money. We'll make this problem go away for you. If the governor asks, we'll assuage him. We'll keep him happy too. We'll keep everything just as it is. If the resurrection is true, it confronts us. It challenges us. We talked about last week how, because the resurrection is true, everything changes. As Sylvia reminded us this morning, death turns to life, fear turns to joy. There's things that we gain from the resurrection being true, but yet there's things that we maybe sometimes have to give up as well. There's things that we're confronted with. There's things that we're challenged by. And there's one who would love for us to ignore all of those challenges. There's one who would love for us to think, in light of the resurrection, you don't have to give anything up. You don't have to change anything about the way you live. You should be yourself. You should live your best life. Be who you want to be. Don't hear any note of challenge. You don't have to give anything up. You can do whatever. There's one who says, you can follow me and follow the way that I live and follow the things that I say are good. And you can have everything. This is, of course, Satan, God's ultimate enemy. And he appears in Matthew chapter 4 on a very high mountain. We looked at this, didn't we, as we looked at the wilderness and Jesus' testing in the wilderness. And in the third test, in the third temptation that Jesus faces when he is battling it out with Satan, he's taken to a very high mountain, shown all the kingdoms of this world, all their splendor. Satan says, all this I will give to you if you will bow down and worship me. He claims to own the whole world, everything on earth. He claims that it is his to give away. And all we need to do is worship him. He would love for us to ignore the challenge of the resurrection, to ignore the challenge of Jesus' lordship. He'd love for us to follow him instead, to think that we can have everything if we just follow him, to just live our own life. But on another mountain, where Jesus was worshipped, not Satan, Jesus was worshipped. Even though some doubted, Jesus was worshipped. On this mountain, Jesus made a claim that totally undercuts anything that Satan said to him, everything that Satan said to him. Satan claimed to own the whole world, but Jesus says, when his disciples are worshiping him, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, Jesus says. What a claim. take a moment and just recognize the scale of that claim. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, Jesus says. How can he make such a claim? What's the route that he's taken that makes him believe he can make such a bold claim? All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. A few weeks ago, Beth and I were down with family in Stratford-upon-Avon for a family gathering, a family celebration. But when you're in the home of Shakespeare, of course, you can't resist but go see a Shakespeare show. At least, that's me. I studied drama at school. For some of you, you might be thinking the complete opposite. But we had the opportunity to go see a Shakespeare performance at the RSC Theatre. And we went to see Henry VI, Part 2. Now, I don't know about you, but I am not very well-versed when it comes to my English kings. I'm not very well-versed when it comes to the War of the Roses. I know it was something about some red roses and some white roses, but it's got nothing to do with a ring of roses, because that's about the plague instead. So I really went into it not knowing much. I'd read a little bit of a synopsis. But as I say, it's set during the War of the Roses, and the Red Rose, the House of Lancashire, and the White Rose, the House of York, were constantly warring, constantly making claims over the throne. The play opens, in fact, with a marriage between the king and the queen, and they go off after the wedding ceremony. Everyone's been jovial and celebrating, and then all of a sudden, the plots and the counterplots start. We've got one person saying, oh, this marriage doesn't bode well. I think we're going to have to keep an eye on this, and he goes off. And then another person says, oh, I don't much like him. We're going to have to depose him from his role, and then they go off. And then another person says, the fools, the lot of them, I can see everything that's going on, and I know how I'm going to claim the throne for myself. And throughout the play, it's constant murder, constant deception, constant death. That was the route to the throne, at least when it came to Shakespeare's plays. What was Jesus' route? Did it involve deception and money, like with the religious priests? Did it involve security, like with the guards? Did it involve violence, like with the kings of Shakespeare's plays? What was the route to his claim, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me? The answer is it actually involved all three. It involved all of these things. But Jesus wasn't the perpetrator. Jesus was the innocent man, the suffering servant, the righteous one. Jesus was arrested by the hand of a deceptive disciple who betrayed him for money. Jesus was handed over to be crucified by a Roman governor who washed his hands of what he was doing in order to protect his own security before the baying crowds and the religious leaders. Jesus suffered at the hands of violent men. He suffered when he was beaten and mocked and whipped and scorned, and he suffered a violent execution on a Roman cross. The route to Jesus' bold claim, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, involved deception, security, and violence. But it wasn't him using those things to his own gain. He had everything, yet he did not use his status for his own advantage. Being equal in very nature with God, he did not consider this to be used to his own advantage. He made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, Philippians chapter 2. The root to Jesus' claim was a path of suffering. And yet, because he walked that path as the sinless, righteous Son of God, God raised him from the dead and confirmed who he is. This is what we have been celebrating on Easter weekend. And in some ways, we come again to the resurrection. We come again to Easter Sunday. And we come to that claim that Jesus is making on the mountain at Galilee after his resurrection. Because of that route that he has walked, Jesus is the only one who can claim all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. And what a claim. The scale of this claim jumps out at us as we read the Great Commission. Jesus says, all authority. Notice how many times all appears in this passage. All authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them. One commentator says, baptizing them in the name of all of God, of the fullness of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything or all I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, all the time, to the very end of the age. The alls of the Great Commission jump out at us. All authority, all nations, all he has commanded, always, all the time. Because Jesus is fully God and fully man. And all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. His claim, just like his resurrection, changes everything, affects everything. In Jesus is the fullness of God, because as he says, surely I am with you always. This is nothing less than a claim to divinity. Matthew opens his gospel by talking of the promise of Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew 1, verse 23. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And at the end of Matthew's gospel, bringing all the themes of his gospel together, he says in the words of Jesus, surely I am with you always. Jesus is God with us. And in Jesus, God with us becomes Jesus with us. The scale of this claim affects everything. All power and glory, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus. In heaven and on earth. Don't kid yourself in thinking that Jesus is only Lord in heaven over the spiritual things. Don't kid yourself in thinking that Jesus is only Lord over a small aspect of our lives. In heaven and on earth, Jesus says. Don't kid yourselves in thinking that Jesus is only Lord over a Sunday morning in heaven and on earth. Jesus is Lord over all of our lives. And he is Lord over all of creation. Jesus' ultimate lordship affects everything in his reign as the sovereign Lord. When it comes to the claims of the resurrection, that the crucified Messiah is not dead, but is risen, A claim that challenges us. A claim that confronts us. A claim that Satan will do everything in his power to try and get us to ignore the ramifications that it has on our lives. Our only option in light of Jesus' authority in heaven and on earth is to come before him and give ourselves to his lordship. Give ourselves to him, to recognize him as Lord and King over our lives, over us, as individuals, as a church. We are to come before him and to give him his due. Jesus is Lord. But if that ever feels daunting, if it feels like Jesus' claim of authority over us and over all of heaven and earth could look anything like the authority that the kings of Shakespeare's plays make, or the authority that dictators in our day to day make when they claim sovereign nations as their own. Remember that the one who made that claim is the same one who walked that path of suffering, who took upon himself our sins, our brokenness, not only by paying the price for our sins and our brokenness on the cross, but actually experiencing the brutality of our sins and our brokenness, experiencing what it's like to be deceived and betrayed and sold for money, experiencing what it's like to suffer violence, experiencing what it's like to be cast aside for execution for the sake of someone's security. He experienced all these things. And in doing so, he brought us into relationship, into the fullness of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Jesus who says, anyone who wants to be my disciple must take up their cross, deny themselves, and come follow me. The Jesus who says, all authority in heaven and on earth belongs to me. Therefore, I am Lord over your life, over everything that you say and do, over everything in your world. It's the same Jesus who said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Who said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Who gave his life as an offering so that we might know life with Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We belong to him. We opened this morning with a bold claim from Voltaire. We are living in the twilight of Christianity. And to that claim, Jesus says, surely I am with you always to the very ends of the age. We are not in the twilight of Christianity. Even when churches might be declining, even when there might be gaps in the demographics of our congregation, we are not in the twilight of Christianity, because even then, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, God with us, Jesus with us, present with us by his Holy Spirit, even then he says, surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. I'm with you when church feels great, and I'm with you when church feels small. I'm with you when being a Christian feels wonderful and Easter Sunday-like, and I'm with you when being a Christian feels like an impossible task. I am with you always to the end of the age. I'm with you when you feel like you're the majority, and I'm with you when you feel like nobody else around you, nobody else in your workplace, in your school, in your neighborhoods, understands what it means to live for Jesus. I am with you always to the very end of the age. How are we to respond to the challenge and the confronting claim that Jesus Christ is risen? How are we to respond to Jesus' claim, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me? Well, as we see in verse 19 and verse 20, we have the Great Commission. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. Disciples making disciples. This is something that God has really laid on my heart this week as I've been preparing to preach on this. So much so that we're coming back to the Great Commission for 3 weeks in May, where we are going to look at in detail what it looks for disciples making disciples, for us to be disciples making disciples, going, baptizing, teaching. But before we look at any of that, before we take on the Great Commission, we have to remember the great claim and the great promise either side of it. The great claim that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus, and the great promise that he is with us always to the very end of the age. And so how do we respond to that? Whether you're a Christian or not, whether you would call yourself a follower of Jesus or not, whether you feel like you've backslid and you don't feel like you're actively following Jesus anymore, or whether you feel fired up more than anything, it's the same. We respond to Jesus' claim, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, by worshiping him. By giving everything of ourselves to him. By recognizing him as Lord. In heaven and on earth and over our whole lives. If you're not a follower of Jesus, then for you, that's your whole life. That's everything. That's giving everything of yourself to him. That's responding to Jesus' command, repent and believe. That's saying to Jesus, I turn from the ways in which I want to keep things as they were, from the ways in which I listen to Satan's voice, from the ways in which I want to maintain my security, from the ways in which I want to ignore the claim that you have on my life. And I recognize you as Lord. But for us as followers of Jesus, it's the same. It's giving Jesus all of our lives. Recognizing that not only has he given his all for us, but also all authority in heaven and on earth belongs to him. If we are going to be disciples making disciples, if we are going to seek to live out the Great Commission, we must first give absolutely everything of ourselves to Jesus, our risen Lord. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to you. Lord Jesus, we are sorry for the times when we respond to the resurrection in a similar way to the chief priests and to the guards, where we do not want to be confronted with the challenge and the worldview that we are not the center of the universe. Where we do not want to be confronted with the challenge and the worldview that it is not all about us. We're sorry for the times when we listen to cheap answers and to counter narratives that shore up our security. Help us to be truly confronted and challenged by the claim of the resurrection that Jesus Christ has risen, and by Jesus' claim himself that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. Help us to give everything of ourselves to you and to allow you to be Lord not only over a small part of our lives, but to be Lord over all aspects of our lives. And remind us of your presence with us, so that when we are tempted to believe the claim that we're in the twilight of Christianity, even though globally Christianity is growing, when we're tempted to believe that claim, when we look around in our own national situation and when we're not having our best of days in our walk of faith, would you remind us of your presence with us always to the very end of the age? And would you remind us of the sweetness of your presence? Because you, Lord Jesus, gave your everything for us when you suffered and died on the cross to bring us into fullness of life and fullness of relationship with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In whose name we pray all of these things. Amen. We're now going to close our time of worship this morning, singing, thinking about that great commission, facing a task unfinished.
Sing a task unfinished that drives us to our knees, a need that undiminished rebukes our slothful ease. We who rejoice to know thee renew before thy throne the solemn pledge we owe thee to go and make thee known. Where other lords beside thee hold their unhindered sway, where forces that defy thee defy thee still today, with none to heed their crying for life and love and light. Unnumbered souls are dying and passing to the night. We go to all the world with kingdom hope unfurled. No other name has power to save but Jesus Christ the Lord. He bare the torch that flaming fell from the hands of those who gave their lives, proclaiming that Jesus died and rose. Ours is the same commission, the same glad message ours. Fired by the same ambition, to thee we yield our powers. We go to all the world with kingdom hope unfurled. No other name has power to save but Jesus Christ the Lord. O Father who sustained them, O Spirit who inspired, Savior whose love constrained them to toil with zeal untired. From cowardice defend us, from lethargy awake. Forth on thine errand send us to labor for thy sake. We go to all the world with kingdom hope unfurled. No other name has power to save but Jesus Christ the Lord. We go to all the world, His kingdom hope unfurled. Power to save but Jesus Christ the Lord.
May you know the lordship of Jesus over your whole life. May you know the goodness of His love and the communion of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit that He welcomes you to through His blood. And may you know the joy and the strength and the power and the life of His presence with you. Not just today, not just this week, but now and forevermore to the very end of the age. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us and worshiping with us this morning.